My name is Chris. I'm one of the pastors here. It's good to be on this spring break Sunday. As Christians, we really hold dear to the truth that God is love. It's a fundamental Christian belief, right? This is love, not that we love God, but that He loved us and sent His Son as an atoning sacrifice for our sins, right? For God so loved the world that He sent Jesus. We love because He first loved us. All our response, all our singing, all our gathering is a response to the God who first loved us. And if you ask me, how do you know that God is love? The place I would point you first would be the person of Jesus. That Jesus is how I know that God is love in the midst of the chaos and inhumanity of history. That Jesus is God's self-disclosure of His love. But Jesus also spoke about God's judgment, which creates a bit of a tension, right? How do we reconcile God's love and God's judgment? How do we live faithfully in that tension, right? If you read Scripture, you see both of those realities there, right? So how do we do that? And this morning, we're going to look at a story that Jesus told, which speaks to this matter. If you're new, we're in the middle of our series called The Stories That Jesus Told, where we look at His various parables. Parables are short stories that contain these life-transforming spiritual truths. And the story we're studying this morning is in Luke chapter 16, starting in verse 19. So if you have your Bibles or your mobile devices, you can turn the ringer off and then flip to the Bible in your phone or, you know, right in front of you, there's a pew Bible. And we're going to look at a story that you're probably not going to like. So I'll just tell you that out of the gate. But let me just read you the first couple verses, maybe as you flip there in your Bible. It starts in verse 19. It says this: "There was a rich man who was dressed in purple and fine linen and lived in luxury every day. At his gate was laid a beggar named Lazarus, covered with sores and longing to eat what fell from the rich man's table. Even the dogs came and licked his sores." So we're introduced to this contrast, a rich man and Lazarus. And we're told the rich man lives in luxury. He wears purple in fine linen, right? Very expensive clothes. He lives in a mansion. He drives a Hummer. His watch is worth 50,000 K, right? I mean, he's wealthy. He's well off. It's possible that he's a political or even a religious leader, because royalty and rulers often wore purple in this day, and linen was worn by priests. And so it's very likely that Jesus is directing this parable at the rich, at the leaders, at those with power and prestige and prominence, those viewed as very important in this day. In fact, before we even get into the story any further, it's important to remind you of what comes before this story, because Jesus is teaching and He says something very significant that will come up on the screen. He says this, He's talking to the Pharisees and He says, "No servant can serve two masters. Either he will hate the one and love the other, or he will be devoted to one and despise the other. You cannot serve God and money." So that's what He's been talking about. And this is the Pharisees' response. The Pharisees, who loved money, heard all of this and were sneering at Jesus. He said to them, "You are the ones who justify yourself in the eyes of men, but God knows your hearts. What is highly valued among men is detestable in God's sight." And so there's a reversal of values in God's kingdom. And then Jesus tells a story about a rich man that will illustrate that what is highly valued among men can be detestable in God's sight. And when we hear about this rich man living in luxury every day, we very likely will distance ourselves from his situation. Because, you know, most of us, we wouldn't say we're rich. And whenever I tend to respond to a story that Jesus is telling like that, I always think back to this experience I had in my early 20s. We did this urban plunge where we went to the downtown east side and lived there for 3 days. And I remember we heard a talk from this woman named Joyce who lives and works on the east side. And she was there to prepare us for the experience and answer our questions. So some of the students, they had the question, you know, what should we wear when we're out walking around and visiting with people? What should we wear so that we don't stick out? And I never will forget what Joyce said. She said, whatever you wear, it's going to be obvious that you don't belong. Like, you could wear a dirty t-shirt with ripped jeans, and you'll be in style. And also, you will be sticking out like a sore thumb. It will be obvious that you don't belong. And then she said, look at you. You're healthy and vibrant and beautiful. Just because we had health and homes and energy and light in our eyes. She says, hey, it's going to be obvious you don't belong. Whatever you wear, your appearance bears the marks of privilege. It might not be purple fabric, but whatever you wear, your appearance bears the marks of privilege. See, sometimes our privilege is apparent to everyone else but us. And the wealth of the Western world so often skews our scale because we are rich in the global village. We are the rich ones. And so as we read this parable, we should be asking ourselves and reflecting, who is outside of our gates? Because for this rich man, it was a beggar named Lazarus. And Lazarus has it very terrible. He is sick. He is ill. This is not a lazy man refusing to work. He's debilitated. He needs the mercy and intervention of others. And it says that he longs to eat from the rich man's table, the crumbs that fall. In my study, I found out that it wasn't uncommon for rich people in this day to eat with their hands, and then they would wipe their hands on bread and then throw the bread out. That's the bread that Lazarus was longing for, the rich man's napkins. And dogs are licking his sores. And there's this remarkable contrast. A man who is very important, who is well known, who is significant, and a man that people ignore and walk by without much of a thought. But what happens next is this great kind of reversal. And Jesus tells the story and what happens. Here we go. Verse 22. You can follow along. The time came when the beggar died, and the angels carried him to Abraham's side. The rich man also died and was buried. In hell, where he was in torment, he looked up and saw Abraham far away with Lazarus by his side. So he called him, Father Abraham, have pity on me and send Lazarus to dip the tip of his finger in water and cool my tongue because I am in agony in this fire. But Abraham replied, Son, remember that in your lifetime you received your good things while Lazarus received bad things? But now he is comforted here and you are in agony. And besides all this, between us and you, a great chasm has been fixed so that those who want to go from here to you cannot, nor can anyone cross over from there to us. He answered, Then I beg you, Father, send Lazarus to my father's house, for I have 5 brothers. Let him warn them so they will not come to this place of torment. Abraham replied, They have Moses and the prophets. Let them listen to them. No, Father Abraham, he said, but if someone from the dead goes to them, they will repent. He said to him, If they do not listen to Moses and the prophets, they will not be convinced, even if someone rises from the dead. So the rich man, the beggar, they die, and all of a sudden you're confronted with this great reversal. Now, we shouldn't push a parable for too many details about the afterlife. That's not how parables work, but it's clear that there is this great reversal that happens. The rich man's in torment in the fire. He pleads with Abraham, the father of the Jewish faith. And he's told that this great chasm has been fixed between the rich man and the poor man. And there's all this lurid kind of imagery that we might even find grotesque, and emotionally we respond very negatively to it. I warned you, you probably wouldn't like this story. But let's just unpack some of the imagery so that we can better understand it. And in the end, I promised you this. You'll find this parable challenging, but not in the way you initially think. So Jesus here, he uses first the image of fire. And the fire is symbolic. I know that because Jesus also describes hell as a place of outer darkness. Fire gives off light. Light dispels darkness. How can hell be a place of darkness and fire? Well, the answer is Jesus is using those as symbols, which makes sense considering this is a parable. Right? And so God is light. Sin separates us from God, leading to darkness. The outer darkness symbolizes separation from God. The fire symbolizes the disintegration of our personhood as we reject the one in whose image we are made. Symbols of this sober reality. And so he's using symbolism here. And then secondly, let me say a word about the torment of the rich man. Because some people have viewed hell as this kind of torture chamber, and because they have that view or that picture in their mind, there's a great difficulty in reconciling that idea with the God of love. And it creates confusion and angst and frustration and maybe even the rejection of Jesus's teaching here. But that idea of a torture chamber is a mischaracterization of what Jesus is talking about. Because there's a difference between torment and torture. And it's more than just semantics. There's a difference between torment and torture. Torment arises from within, whereas torture is inflicted from without. I can be tormented by back pain, or I can be tortured because you are constantly cutting my back in order to cause me pain, which I know you wouldn't do. But torment arises from within. Torture is afflicted from without. I'm not saying that God doesn't actively judge unrepentant sin. I am saying to view hell as God's torture chamber is profoundly misleading. And when you look at this word agony, it's the English word agony, it's a translation of a Greek word. When you look at that word and how it's used elsewhere in the New Testament, it becomes clear that we're on the right track here. There's two other places in the New Testament where this Greek word translated as agony in our story appear. The first time is when Mary and Joseph in the Gospel of Luke realize that Jesus, the 12-year-old Jesus, is missing. Right? It's when they go to the temple, they find out he's missing, and it says they anxiously search for him. It's the same Greek word translated as anxious that's used in our story. The word describes emotional distress when they realize the boy they love is missing. The other time it's used is in the book of Acts when Paul is leaving Ephesus and the church leaders realize they probably won't see him again. And there the word is translated as grieved, that they were grieved. And both of those passages picture this emotional anguish that arises from within. And the same word is used by Luke here, who wrote the book of Acts and the Gospel of Luke. And so it makes good sense to conclude that the rich man is in agony, in anguish, arising from within because something he loves, something he's built his entire identity upon, his riches, has been taken from him. And he is more than that, waking up to the fact that he has missed the entire purpose of his existence. You could imagine a weeping and a gnashing of teeth. But despite all that, the third thing we can notice is that the rich man doesn't have this repentant attitude. His immediate response is to try to boss Abraham around, to boss Lazarus around. As soon as he finds he can't get to heaven, he wants to drag Lazarus into hell to serve him and to alleviate his situation. The very thing the rich man refused to do for Lazarus on earth. He still wants to rule over the fate of someone like Lazarus. He's not a repentant sinner going, God, please, please forgive me. It's like he's still giving orders. It's almost like he'd rather reign in hell than serve in heaven. And it reminds me of an illustration I heard once. In both heaven and hell, there were banquet tables filled with lavish food. And the residents of both places were invited to eat. There was only one catch. They couldn't use their hands. Instead, they were given forks 3 feet long. They all had these forks, and they had to use these forks. And in heaven, people feasted. But in hell, people starved. Why? Because in heaven, they use the forks to serve one another. Yet in hell, they tried to feed themselves, and it didn't work. Right? He who has ears to hear, let them hear. Self was prominent, not service. This rich man, it's like he would rather reign in hell than serve others in heaven. He doesn't ask for forgiveness. He just tries to drag Lazarus into his circumstance. He cannot accept this great reversal that has occurred. Now here's the fourth thing. You notice that the text says the chasm is fixed. There's this great chasm that has been fixed. It's important to realize that God didn't create this chasm originally when he declared all of creation to be good. Just like if you were to plan out a country, you would prefer a country without prisons. Prisons are a response to the rebellion of people, but you'd prefer a country without them. See, we created this chasm by our sin. We introduced this rift into the created order. Right? God is love. God is love, but love requires a free choice. You can't force someone to freely love you. A person can choose to reject your love and rebel against you and live their lives apart from you, which can have very real negative consequences even in this life, right? People can choose consistently what is bad for them until it becomes almost impossible to choose otherwise as character gets formed and fixed. Just think of addiction. And we can become addicted to ourselves as the highest authority in our own lives, to the point where we refuse to give it up, where we refuse to let go of our autonomy, where we refuse to let go of the ability to define reality as we see fit. That's the rich man's refusal. To be free to love is to be free to choose, but we can choose poorly. God respects our choices because he wants people, not puppets. People in love, not people coerced from above. He wants a marriage, not a marionette. People, not puppets on a string. That involves freedom. Freedom to love, but also freedom to reject that love. And it's not just that God is love. It's that God is just. That something within us, at times when we see vile, unaddressed evil, something in us cries out for justice, even for judgment. And we want a God of justice, especially for those unaddressed evils in our world. And listen to what Joshua Butler writes on this parable and this chasm, because you can't read this parable isolated from the tragedies of this world, or it feels like an overreaction. But listen to what he says about the chasm. He says, the boundary does something more than simply prevent hell from invading the new creation. It also prevents the new creation from being dragged into hell. God will not let the rich man drag Lazarus back down with him. No longer will God let the warlord recruit the children soldier into a living hell. The rapist lured the drunken girl into his burning bed. The terrorist inflicted his vindictive flames on innocent families. When God banishes the power of hell from his new creation, his new world is secure. You see, the chasm is a response to the chaos we have unleashed in this world, the ways in which we have abused and misused this beautiful gift of freedom that God has given to us. The gift that makes possible love and virtue and everything that's meaningful about our existence has also been misused, leading to chaos and horror. This chasm is God's response to our chaos, and it is in part an answer, in part, to the age-old question known as the problem of evil. And you could state it like this: if God is all good, he would defeat evil. If God is all powerful, he could defeat evil. But evil is not defeated. Therefore, no such God exists. If God is all good, he would defeat evil. If God is all powerful, he could defeat evil. But evil is not defeated. Therefore, no such God exists. You see, this parable tells us the third premise is the wrong one. The Bible says God is all good and God is all powerful, and so there will be no more evil. Evil is not defeated, but it will be defeated. We say, why not now? Why not in this moment? Well, because evil is not just out there, it is in here. And God wants to remove evil without removing us, so he gives us time to repent. God is patient, not wanting any to perish, but all to come to repentance. And we're urged not to make excuses like this rich man. Right? Send Lazarus to tell my brothers. But Abraham knows the problem, or Jesus knows the problem is not information. The problem is not ignorance. The problem is a hard heart that can't even be convinced by a miracle. So if we hear the Spirit's calling, let us not harden our hearts, because we can say no to God so many times, it gets harder and harder to say yes. And that's how one of Jesus' most disturbing parables ends. But I want to suggest to you, it is disturbing for a different reason than we normally assume. We might say on an intellectual level, I don't like this parable because there's all this talk about fire and it seems grotesque and it seems a little mean, and maybe I feel like it's an overreaction because I live in the West in a cushy place where I don't see all these evils that other people are going through. And so we might have this intellectual response, but I want to suggest to you that it's uncomfortable for an entirely different reason. And instead of mining this parable for details about the afterlife, I want to look at something very, very curious. I want you to look back at the text and notice something. Jesus tells you about a rich man, and he is not named. But the beggar is given a name, the name Lazarus. This is the only character in all of Jesus' parables that is given a name. Usually we hear about farmers and fathers and judges and servants. We never hear about Bob or Rick or Jerry. Yet here the beggar Lazarus is given a name. When Jesus makes a move like that, it's always significant. Right? Giving the poor man a name humanizes him. His poverty is not allowed to define him. See, this parable is less about heaven and hell and far more about rich and poor and mercy and compassion. This parable is about a great reversal in the future that forces us to ask the question, that forces the Pharisees who loved money to ask the question, do our current lives in the here and now reflect the great reversal that is coming? Are the values of heaven reflected in our current lives? Because Jesus' parables again and again are describing what it looks like when God's future world breaks into our present reality. We're supposed to live in light of this future, in light of this great reversal, and think about our day. We know the rock stars and movie stars and successful business people, right? We have posters of them on our walls. We spend money to consume their goods. We enjoy their creativity. We know their names. Yet we don't often know the names of those on the downtown east side, do we? But God does. See, God knows the names that we forget about, because God's kingdom is different. God loves the person, Katy Perry, but the rooms of heaven are not covered with her posters. She is not the famous one there. In heaven, the humble are exalted, and the exalted are humbled, and God cares for those left outside the gates. God knows their names. Do we? You see, when we stop doing the MAP program and housing the homeless for a month during the winter, because now there's a permanent shelter, when we stopped doing that, we lost something very precious. And it wasn't a ministry. It was the names and stories of people who are often marginalized in society, but who remain precious to God. That's why it's as a church, I think it's important that we get involved with 3030 Gordon, because they're the city's housing people who struggle with addictions. And so often, these people tend to be viewed as problems instead of persons, as statistics to be solved instead of stories to be known, as people who are precious image bearers of God. God knows their names, do his people. You see, Lazarus gets a name. The only one in all of the parables, the poor beggar outside the rich man's gate, Lazarus. He is not forgotten. He is known and loved by God, and a great reversal is coming where that will be apparent to all. Right? There's a great reversal coming. So do or does our current lives or current values reflect the great reversal of God's kingdom? This rich man's life did not. And as one commentator writes, the rich man suffered the rich man suffered reversal in the afterlife, not because he was rich, which isn't a sin in itself, but because he was rich and lacked compassion for the needy. He could callously feast each day and ignore the needs of poor Lazarus lying at his gate. He suffered irreversible damnation because he lacked a repentance that produced fruit. His actions reveal a heart never made tender by repentance and regeneration. God's love did not abide in him. God's love did not abide in him. His heart was callous and cold, revealing he never truly experienced a saving faith that led to good works, acts of mercy and compassion. He was calloused instead of caring. He consumed rather than served. God's love did not abide in him. Does it abide in us? This is very challenging. I let these stories work me over all week, and then I drag you along with me. This parable is not about something that's hard to believe regarding the next life. It's about something that's hard to do in this life. And as I studied this text again and again, this quote from a Danish philosopher, Soren Kierkegaard, I think he wrote in the 19th century, only lived to 37, it kept coming back to me to the point where I couldn't shake it. And it's this prophetic little quote that's really exaggerated, okay, and a little tongue-in-cheek and satirical, but it forces us to reflect. And I wish I had it on the slide, and I don't. Late edition. But listen to these words. The matter is quite simple. The Bible is very easy to understand, but we Christians are a bunch of scheming swindlers. We pretend to be unable to understand it because we know very well that the minute we understand, we are obliged to act accordingly. Herein lies the real place of Christian scholarship. Christian scholarship is the church's invention to defend itself against the Bible, to ensure that we can continue to be good Christians without the Bible coming too close. Oh, priceless scholarship, what would we do without you? Dreadful it is to fall into the hands of the living God. Yes, it is even dreadful to be alone with the New Testament. Do you know why I thought of this quote when I studied this parable? Because again and again, we have read this parable in an ahistorical way and made it about details regarding the afterlife so that we as Christians can say, Jesus has punched my ticket to heaven, nothing to worry about here, while totally ignoring whether or not the values, the kingdom values, are being reflected in our lives and in our wealth, which is the point of this parable. It's a challenge to the religious leaders. Do you care about the people outside of your gate? Do your current lives reflect this great reversal that is coming in the values of the kingdom? Where things that men love and cherish, like power and prestige and prominence, can be detestable in the sight of God? When not stewarded well for his glory and the benefit of others, especially the marginalized and oppressed? Like that's the whole driving point. It's meant to make us feel very uncomfortable, but not in the way we originally thought. There's a man named Tim. If you're new to church, welcome. I mean, wow. It's not always like this, but it's Jesus' fault, not mine. So, there's a man named Tim, and he attends a church, and he's not a pastor, and he's not a worship leader. And he's not a prominent figure in the congregation. But every Wednesday evening, Tim and a group of his friends, they go downtown, they spend time with teenagers and who don't have a home. And Tim has no agenda, brings no expectations. He just goes to hang out, shows love, brings the occasional pair of new socks. And Tim listens to the city's homeless sons and daughters. He hears their stories. He listens to their struggles. And what's amazing about Tim is, like, he has a difficult home life. His wife, sadly, had a mental breakdown, and for her safety, she was moved into a care facility. Tim didn't divorce her. Every week, he visits her, spends time with her to listen to her and know her. Every Sunday, he picks her up for church, and they sit together with their son. Tim serves people who are hurting and sick. Tim knows their names. Yet many people don't know Tim's name. Tim is not even his name. He's not on stage. His name is not on a church website. He's written no books. He has no public platform. Yet in the kingdom of God, it should be no surprise to see Tim and Lazarus dancing close to the throne, because God's economy and his kingdom values are different. There are countless individuals who are not known and celebrated by the world. No power, prestige, or privilege to be spoken of. But they are known and celebrated by God. And that thought actually makes me happy. That God views things differently. He sees past the facade to what is underneath. And what matters most in his kingdom is not a platform or power or prestige. It's the person we're becoming. What is highly valued in the world is detestable in God's sight. And Jesus tells this parable to challenge the religious leaders and us to ask the question, who is God placed outside of our gates? Right? We say it again and again. We're not called to do something about everything. That's overwhelming and paralyzing. But we're all called to do something about something. Who is God placed outside of our gates? Doesn't have to be someone who's in a bad financial state. It's just human need. It's not the nameless masses. It may be one person with one name and one story. They're probably already in your life. So who is God placed outside of your gate? And here's the last thing I'll say. We can't just identify with the rich man. If we do that, we might develop a savior complex. We also need to identify with Lazarus sitting outside of the gate, but in our case, spiritually bankrupt, right? In great need, totally reliant on the mercy of another. And the difference is, unlike the religious leaders that Jesus was speaking to, Jesus saw our plight and he left the riches of heaven for the poverty of earth. He crossed the great divide from heaven to earth. He didn't want heaven without us, so he bridged the gap to bring heaven to us. Because though we are spiritually poor and needy, we are precious in his sight, and he knows our name, and he knows our stories, and he wants to redeem them and make them new in his kingdom. And that is the gospel. Not earned, it's a gift given, and we live our lives in response to that gift. So we may be rich on a global scale, but we're also Lazarus, spiritually speaking, in need of God's intervention. And so here's what I want to do, because this is such a challenging word. I want to give us space. I don't want us to shake off maybe what the Holy Spirit's speaking to us. I want to invite just silence for at least a few minutes. I know that's weird. We don't do it often. But I want you to have some time to talk to God. And maybe it's just repentance, because you recognize that there's a callousness in your heart to those in need. Or maybe it's this, maybe you need to ask the Holy Spirit to reveal or to remind you who he's put outside of your gate. Or maybe this morning you just feel like Lazarus, you're in desperate need, and I'd invite you to invite God into that situation. And don't leave this place without reaching out for a hand. And so let me just invite the Holy Spirit to speak to us. And then we'll bow our heads in silence. And this is a time where you can just interact with God. If you're not a prayer, you can maybe try praying or just sit in silence. So Father God, I thank you for your word. And Holy Spirit, in the silence, we invite you to speak to us. To take this parable, to take the things we've heard and apply them to our lives. To speak to us about who you've placed outside of our gates. So Holy Spirit, come. And in this silence, may we know that you are God.